part of my role here is looking at privacy, and obviously GDPR falls into that remit. So a little bit about myself before I get started. I have a very non-linear career path. So my my background, I was educated in IT. I worked in IT for a couple years as a IT network administrator. And then I joined the police service. And I became a police officer in the city of Edmonton. I was a regular patrol cop for a bunch of years. And then about 3 years into my career, somebody caught wind that I knew something about computers, and I got dragged into pretty much every special project that had something that plugged into a wall. Police are not well known for their technical savviness, unfortunately. I spent 10 years with the police service there doing various patrol projects versus mobile computer upgrades. I worked on a dispatch system. I worked on a mobile car reporting system, and then I also would go back out and go catch bad guys and put drunks in jail and do all that fun stuff. Spent my last 2 years there in the technological crime unit, which obviously exposed me to things like cyber breaches, child exploitation investigations, identity theft, a lot of identity theft investigations, drugs, homicides, the whole thing. And then I ended up moving out of there and realizing that private industry offered me a lot more money and a lot more opportunity to expand my horizons and potentially work somewhere where there was no snow. So I moved into consulting about 12 years ago now, and worked for a few different firms, and as I said, I came from Canada down here. So looking forward to obviously getting to know all of you over the next few months. So GDPR. We're going to talk today about the background behind privacy. Why do we care about privacy? Why is it becoming such a relevant and obviously everyone in this room reads the newspaper and has internet access. We know that pretty much every day there's some form of data breach that is exposing our personal information to people who are potentially going to use it for ill-gotten gain. We're going to talk specifically about GDPR today. We're going to talk about how to comply with GDPR. Now, we've got 90 minutes. I'm going to plan to talk for about 60 or so, and then I'm going to open up the floor to questions because there's a lot of information here. I mean, just like anything else, if anybody else is involved in the compliance space and you've been dealing with anti-money laundering regulations, you'll know that the regulations are this thick and the guidance notes are this thick, which basically means that when we put things into initial law, there's a whole lot of ambiguity that goes along with that law and the interpretation over time of how we're going to apply that law, how it's going to become practically implemented, and how it's going to be enforced. And I think GDPR is going to be another prime example of that. And right at the end, I'm going to tell you why GDPR is going to be a long slope to actual implementation. Once we go through a lot of the sort of detailed stuff about GDPR, I know at least one person in the room has seen me speak on this. I did a 20-minute high-speed version of this, left out a lot of detail. We're going to go right at the end. I'm going to give you 6 bullet points of things that you need to do right now to get yourself going and make sure that you're on track and that you have your clients have an outward perception that you are working towards compliance. So let's talk a bit about privacy. Here's the world in 1995. We had 91 million mobile subscribers, which seems like a pretty large number, but that was back in the days of early cell phones. You think 91 million subscribers, that's not the population of even North America, right? So if you think about how many people back then had cell phones and were connected, the internet usage, we had 45 million internet users, nothing compared to what we have today, right? We look at things like,63.9 million terabytes of monthly internet traffic. That seems like a lot, it's not, right? 2.1 billion internet-enabled devices. Here's where we stand in 2014. Right. So we had 9 billion mobile subscribers, 7.3 billion internet-enabled devices. Right? These are all these things that are out there now, not just our smartphones, obviously computers. There are so many things now, watches, TVs, right? Refrigerators that can order your groceries for you when you run low on milk. Right? All these things are becoming internet. Home stuff, we've got your home thermostat. If you have a Nest thermostat, you can monitor from home, right? All these things are internet connected, and they all have data associated to them. If you're going to own a Nest, does anybody know the parent company that owns Nest? Google. Google bought Nest. Why did they buy Nest?
To get the data.
To get the data, right? So what do they know about you now? So to use your Nest device, you need to have a Google account. You set up a Google account, well guess what? Google now knows when you come in and out of your house. If you're not familiar with the Nest thermostats, they are smart, intelligent thermostats. They have motion sensors built into them that track activity in your home so that it can adjust the temperature based on whether there's somebody there or not. So now Google knows when you're at your house and when you're not. They may not know when you're sitting on the couch watching Netflix for 2 hours at a time because you haven't moved, but that's the kind of information that's being collected by companies. And of course, Google has the ability to aggregate that information with all sorts of other points of data that they can then use to do what? Market to you. So they go and buy new things. So obviously, privacy is becoming more and more important. How many people here in the room have not had their credit card skimmed or disabled at some point? Yeah, right. So here's my point. We've all suffered at least one data breach, right? There's a really good website. You can register for it. It's called Have I Been Pwned, which is P-A-W-N-E-D. And what it does is you put your email address into it, and it has a database of all publicly known data breaches where the information has been released onto the internet. And it will go through those databases and compare your email address that you provided, and it will give you a report that says your email information has been breached in the following data breaches. And you can sign up for alerts. Oh, usually once every 6 months or so, I get an email from them that's saying, oh, your email was compromised in the following breach. Usually it's something that I'm not even sure what it is quite often, because I mean with emails, you could be in a lot of different places. So I have to go Google the breach. Oh yeah, what did they lose, right? So Adobe, for example, my account was breached in Adobe. I had bought Adobe Photoshop a number of years ago, so I'm looking at that, and it's like, okay, what was lost? Well, they lost user account information, they lost credit card information. All right, when did I buy that Adobe software? Okay, it was at least 10 years ago. That credit card is long gone and not active anymore. So what's exposed? Probably my home address, don't live there anymore. Probably, you know, minimal information, not too worried about it. But it just gives you some insight into the things that you're being exposed to, right? You read things in the paper, how many people have not heard of the Equifax data breach? Does everybody know what Equifax is? You might not be familiar with that here. Equifax is the North American, so US and Canadian, it is the credit monitoring agency. So every time you get a credit card, every time you apply for a store credit card, every time you sign up for a credit account being, for example, a postpaid phone. So for example, if you were in North America and you signed up for a phone with Flo and you wanted a postpaid account, they would put your information into Equifax. And that is a general repository. So I have a report from Equifax that is about 12 pages long that is my entire life history of credit from when I got my very first credit card when I was 18 years old all the way up until what I did when I moved 3 months ago. That database has your credit information, your account information, all your addresses. It has your past employers and current employers information. It is a treasure trove of basically personal private information that can be used for committing identity theft. They had their systems breached. So, you know, these are companies like this. Obviously, this is a global provider for credit information. Microsoft has had breaches, right? Adobe, Google, Yahoo was another really big one. Home Depot, Target, right? So all these companies with really, really deep pockets have suffered data breaches. So if people like that, companies like that with deep pockets aren't able to protect their data, what are the chances are that small and medium businesses that you're sharing your information with are going to do a better job? Probably pretty slim. So obviously, as a result of that, we are now looking at the importance of privacy regulation and putting some teeth behind the obligation to protect. So, you know, as you can see here now, we've looked at, there's been some things that have developed. We had the UK Data Protection Act, which is probably the most relevant thing, being the fact that we're obviously an offshore territory. We have, you know, a lot of links back to the UK, and we have a lot of companies that we're associated with there. That UK Data Protection Act came into effect in 1998 and put controls around companies and expectations around protection of information. GDPR obviously comes along in, well, the law came along in 2016. We saw it come into force on the 25th of May, so just about a month ago. What really sort of struck a chord with people with GDPR was that it had extraterritorial reach, okay? And that basically meaning that normally most laws, you know, the UK Data Protection Act applied to the UK and companies that were operating within the UK. GDPR has a global reach and global impact. And how they've done that is basically to say, if you are holding data on behalf of a EU citizen who resides in the EU, you have an obligation to protect that information under GDPR. So that's the first big question. I mean, I get a lot of phone calls. The first big question usually from companies here is, I don't think this applies to me because I don't do business with, you know, with companies or things in the EU. And we start talking, and usually 9 times out of 10, they'll be like, ooh, yeah, you're right, actually, we do have a client that lives in, you know, France. Yeah, okay, so we have one. It's like, you have one, it applies. And all the things that come around with having GDPR compliance now come into it. So policies and procedures, having consent notices, and all those things that are part of this of the program. Some clients have chosen look at the amount of effort, time, and money they're going to spend, and they've actually decided to shed themselves of smaller numbers, pools of clients, to get away from having to comply with this. Short-term solution, yes. So for those of you who are here, you're probably aware that in January of this year, the Cayman Data Protection Regulations are going to come into effect, and you are going to have basically a similar level of standard that's going to be applied by law here. So yes, you may be able to skirt it now, but frankly, it's coming next year anyways. So Cayman is looking towards getting itself being a equivalent jurisdiction status, which basically means that the level of controls within the law are going to be recognized by the EU as being very, very similar to GDPR, and therefore data transfers can happen back and forth between the countries without further processing. So what is privacy? Kind of encompasses sort of three major things: integrity and data accuracy, cybersecurity, obviously protecting it, and rights and transparency. And the rights and transparency piece is really where we're sort of seeing the push from the general public and to understand what data do you collect, you know, on behalf of your company from me? What data do you use? What data do you share? How do you use my data? Do I have access to my data if I'm, you know, request information? These are the things that are really solidified in GDPR. There's obviously been an expectation for cybersecurity. You know, that doesn't come as a surprise to anybody. You're expected, if you're going to collect information, that you're going to put up appropriate firewalls and controls. You're not going to leave corporate laptops with unencrypted information on the seat of your car while you go have a drink at the bar. Right, there's things like that are just common sense activities. Integrity and data accuracy. A lot of things are happening now with artificial intelligence. It is using this data in ways that are non-human intervened, right? So you've got computers that are now making decisions based on the information that's been collected about you. And making sure that obviously the data that has been collected is accurate and that it's being used in an ethical manner and it's being used with your consent, right? So that you know what information is being, you know, manipulated to make decisions. So has anybody heard of Cambridge Analytics?
Yes.
Anybody not heard of Cambridge Analytics? If you own Facebook stocks, you probably had a couple of rough weeks there with Cambridge Analytics. Cambridge Analytics basically put an app up on the Facebook site. People downloaded it. It was one of those, I never actually saw it. From what I understand, it's one of these, you know, do this quiz and we'll tell you what your favorite soda pop is, right? Like one of those kind of things. Pointless, but what it did was, is it farmed all the information in your Facebook profile. And it farmed information about your friends that you were connected to. And it took all that information and it put it into a giant database where Cambridge Analytics has now been accused, and Cambridge Analytics has is insolvent. They are completely out of business because no one will touch them now. And they were have been accused of using that data to manipulate voting polls and manipulate data feeds during the election, the US elections, to try and manipulate people's votes. So pretty significant, right? This is what's happening behind the scenes. And the question obvious to that is that, you know, what's the integrity issues with that? And even the ethical, right? We as a society, I think, have all decided that the ethical piece of that was unacceptable, and therefore Cambridge Analytics is no more.
But I'm listening. But are they the only ones who use and, I mean, like for instance, all these sort of games that they have on Facebook? Is it possible that others are doing it, but it's not on the level as that organization?
Absolutely. I can guarantee you that Microsoft is going through every app right, Facebook's going through every app right now, looking to see what's been collected by these to make sure that they don't have another one of these waiting in the wings, right? There's a lot of embarrassment. I'm sure Mark Zuckerberg did not enjoy sitting in front of the Senate committee having to ask questions about his company. Did anybody watch the interviews?
Yeah,
that was actually quite entertaining. So, I mean, sad that I think that, but it was quite entertaining to watch Mark Zuckerberg sit there and sweat it out. There was a lot of, I'll get back to you on that question that were asked of him. So privacy rights. Who are the privacy rights designed for? So there's really sort of two sides of this, right? The rights of the individual, what rights do we have as individuals to protect and control our data? But then at the same accord, companies are, you know, there to provide us services, to provide us with goods. They need information to be able to do that role. And it's the balance in between that we're trying to get to. Historically, I think everything was very, very swung towards the rights of the organization. Once they had your data, they pretty much had the right to do whatever they wanted with it. How many people actually sat down and, you know, read the 12-page disclosure documents that are attached to things that they purchase or buy online? It doesn't happen, right? I mean, I'm guilty of it. I try to minimize the information that I put in there. You know, things that drive me crazy are the, you know, you want to use our free airport Wi-Fi? You know, just put your email address in here. Of course, nothing's free, right? So you know if you put your email address in there that you're going to get spammed or you're going to get a whole bunch of materials coming at you. You know, and that's sort of the, well, we have a right to provide that service, and we need that information to do that. So there's a whole lot of noatthanks.com emails out there, because that's what I like to use. So much so that I think people or companies have clued into it, because I tried it the other day in Houston, and it actually said, that is not a NetGalley email address. It's like, oh, they're on to me. So what is personal information? This is where it gets a little bit confusing, because I think in the sort of general sense, people really sort of understand things like my name, my date of birth, my sex, my address, my, you know, tax information number, things like that that are attributed to me as an individual that organizations and companies would use as part of providing services to me. But there's a lot of other stuff in there that really has also been deemed by GDPR as being personal information, right? What is your religion? What is your sexual orientation, right? What is, you know, what are your hobbies? So the fact that I am a pretty fanatical scuba diver on itself doesn't really mean much. If you just knew that there was a scuba diver in the room, you really couldn't do that much with that information. But if you knew that I was a scuba diver, maybe you would then want to market information or products to me. Or trips, you know, I get a lot of vacations and boating trips and things in all my feeds. So things like that, you know, really haven't been historically recognized as being personal information. Biometrics, right? So how many people have a newer iPhone? or I can unlock my phone with the touch of my fingerprint. So I have, you know, granted biometric information to this device to make my life easier. Is Apple capable of protecting that information? How many people heard the other day there was a, I believe it was, I don't want to get this wrong now, I think it was a Google Echo that, so these are these new where you basically, you know, talk to your little device and say, oh, hey, order me a new toilet paper. Sure, how many would you like? Play this song. Okay, playing this song for you. Similar to Siri, right? If you got an iPhone, hey Siri, tell me the address of so-and-so. Is there any Chinese restaurants around here? Whatever it is. What happened was a couple was having a private conversation in their home, and the device misheard some of the conversation and ended up recording the conversation and emailed it to a third party that was in their contact information. So this person gets this message, phones them up and says, did you mean to send this to me? Now, I don't think that it was anything nefarious as far as the conversation went. But it sort of, you know, and then, you know, they were obviously concerned. I mean, I do not have one of these devices in my home. I, as a security privacy person, having an always-on listening device just makes me feel a little bit uncomfortable at this point. And that event solidified that for me, that I'm just not prepared to have something like that in my home. So some things you may not think about, okay? So obvious, name, passport number, driver's license number. Does anybody know what an IMEI is? No, I'm not even gonna wait for an answer. Every one of these mobile devices has an IMEI number attached to it. Is it a serial number? Every time a data packet leaves this device and heads off to a tower, that IMEI is attached to that piece of data. It is attributable to your phone, your account. So anywhere that packet travels around the world, it could be linked back to you. Right? IP addresses. Every device that's on the internet has an IP address associated to it. You've probably heard that term before. That IP address is unique to one device on the internet. Because if they have more than one with the same address, you would get conflicts and the data wouldn't arrive and things would get messed up. Where that's important, so I brought this up in one of the sessions we did, the quick talk sessions. If your company has a website, everyone who connects to your website is passing their IP information to your web server, because that's the only way that your web server can respond back with the information they need to display the screen. So depending on whether you're hosting your own web server or whether you've got a third-party service provider that's hosting that web server for you, you may have IP addresses that are attributable to people who are in the EU. Now, do you have an obligation to protect that information? Technically, yes, you do. So what I would say is, don't host your own website internally. Give it up to a third-party provider and make sure in your contract agreement with them that they have the responsibility to deal with that, not you. The digital footprint. I think in general our lives have been enriched from an information perspective. I mean, I laugh now, I think back, right? We're sitting in a bar and we're having a conversation and we disagree on something. What's the first thing everyone does? Pull out your phone and you Google it and everyone has the answer within a minute. In the old days, you'd argue about it for 2 hours, drink 3 more beers, and then everyone would just go home angry and forget about it. But I think the other side of it is, it also, for me, it also makes me a lot more hesitant to say things because I always feel like someone's going to Google and challenge me on it. So you really need to know your stuff when you open your mouth now.
Listen, I have a question. For the IP address and the ID for your cell phone,
yeah.
If someone is tracking that, what would they find? I know they use it to track like the Bitcoin stuff like that, but when somebody tracks that detail, what would they find? Just a location? Does it link to your name, your address? What do they find?
Let me tell you a police story. So obviously government has some authorities and powers. When I was a police officer working in the TechCrime unit, I was asked to participate in a homicide investigation, and it was a historical one. Guys had been, it was a gang-related murder, guy had been shot on his driveway a year earlier, and they basically knew who was responsible, but they just didn't have enough evidence to be able to lay charges. So what they decided to do was, is we got a warrant that allowed us to do capturing of internet data related to those individuals. So this was, and this was some time ago now, so this was probably 15 years ago. So we actually got a piece of software from the FBI called Carnivore. If you want to Google that, it's an interesting Wikipedia entry. Carnivore was a tool that basically could capture all the packets coming into a internet service provider and could strip out specific ones based on the IP address, and you could recreate in real time the screens that were happening, that the people were seeing. So we had 7 targets we were monitoring, and I literally sat in a room for about 14 hours a day, 6 days a week, and watched every single thing these guys did on the internet. I read all their chats, I looked at every web page, I viewed all their emails, and that's what I did. And the reason we could do that is because we knew that if you go, for example, here, Flo, right, if you've got internet at your house, there will be an IP address assigned to the devices in your home. And we knew, we just basically went to the provider and said, what's the IP addresses for this address of this house? And they said, okay, this is what it is. We said, great. We're going to put our tap in, these are the IP addresses we want, and we just suck every bit of data out of there and we monitor. Now, that was law enforcement, that was done under legal purpose. Unfortunately, these guys were super, super nervous, and so then the plan B was, go out and bug these guys. So we sent the undercover guys out and harassed them, saying, well, we're close, we're going to get you right away, and hoping that they knew not to talk on the phone, because they'd been wiretapped a number of times. But we were hoping they would go home and chat on their phone or their devices back and forth, and we would be able to get some information out of that. What ended up happening is that I spent 6 months looking at a lot of porn. and I got paid. That was my job, and that's how we were using that information. So, you know, and we talk about how can that information be used, like, for example, in an airport, right? So the airport Wi-Fi is open, it's unsecured, it's not encrypted. Everything that you're sending back and forth through that through the airport can basically be intercepted by somebody and can be read or recreated. They can look at those web pages. Obviously, if you're using things, when you see HTTPS, right, you see that S at the end, that means secure. It means that is an end-to-end encrypted traffic. That stuff is protected. But if you're just looking at, you know, some small business's website, the chances of them having a secure website, you put in banking information, buy something online, you're potentially putting your information at risk.
So the combined information that leads to the identity of the person you're tracking them, not necessarily just one event.
Well, in that case, they're using that data that could potentially contain information that has more private stuff in it, right? So if they're intercepting the packets that come through, it could have banking information, it could have one of the ones, you know, like getting into, could you have your email password? Your email password's not encrypted. Get into your email, and then, you know, I've seen ones where they take your broker information and they'll send emails to your broker saying, oh, hey, can you please liquidate my brokerage account? And, oh, I want to send it to this bank account in Hong Kong. Right? And they'll do things like that.
Does a VPN protect you?
If it's configured properly, that is the intent of a VPN, which is a virtual private network. So the idea of that is you basically have a encrypted tunnel on the internet. So for example, our KPMG laptops, if I want to connect in, see my email, I want to go into our chat system, or I want to connect to one of our servers, I have to have a VPN running, which then creates this encrypted tunnel. You know, all businesses that are linking back to their own companies, their own mail servers, really should be using that kind of technology. Interest of time, we'll move forward. So clicking away privacy, the I agree waiver. I mentioned a little bit earlier, right? We've all done this, we're all guilty of this. You wanna proceed? Yeah, click, yes, I accept. Please read our acceptable use. Yeah, whatever, click, 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 we all do it. And you know, this one here is a bit of a joke, but it basically says that we're informing you, the information we receive for the service that we offer to you and to others such as your friends or partners, advertisers who purchase publicity on the site, and developers of games, applications, and websites. But that is the reality, right? If people are in the market of collecting information for marketing purposes, they will use it for whatever they can, right? You are the product that they are selling. So like this one, two piggies in a barn. Nothing is free in life, right? If somebody offers you something free, there's usually an ulterior motive that comes across from it, right? Now we talk about Facebook, right? People view Facebook as this great way to connect with people. If you have family overseas, friends, you travel for business lots, you may, you know, I use Facebook. I use it sparingly, but I do like it because I have a lot of friends globally that it makes it really easy for me to keep track of them and sort of, you know, give you a, maybe not necessarily an accurate view, but a window into the perfect view of everyone's life, right? Because that's all anyone ever posts. Vacations, look at my new car, look at this awesome dinner I'm having tonight. I've never seen anybody post a picture of themselves doing laundry, or, you know, maybe the odd grocery shopping trip, but, you know. So GDPR. We'll begin into talking about the legalities of GDPR and really what it's trying to enforce. It came into force on May 25th, right? So a month ago, it basically became in a position where if you're non-compliant, that you could be subject to fines as a result of that. The idea of GDPR was to try and harmonize privacy laws across Europe. So prior to that, Germany had its own law. France had its own law, the UK had its own law, and they all differed and had, you know, different authorities. In the interest, obviously, of the EU and trying to combine, GDPR is one of those goals in trying to create a harmonized legal framework so that we can, obviously, implement and protect data. Trying to give individuals greater control of their information, right? So we talked about how people now have the authority to make decisions about the data that's being collected. How that data is going to be used and processed and how it's going to be shared. It's reflective of the digital age, right? We all have smartphones now. There's things that you can't even do anymore without having a digital device. I did a drug undercover course. This was a bunch of years ago. It wasn't really the concept of digital stuff, but part of one of the things that we did for our training is that they took away our wallets, watches, keys, everything, identification, left us with nothing but the clothes on our back, drove us from Edmonton to Calgary, put us out on a street corner, and said, your job today is to eat, find a place to sleep, and make some money. Figure out how you're going to do that. Well, have you ever tried to rent a hotel without a credit card? It is virtually impossible. The only hotel that you can get without a credit card is not a place you want to sleep. So even though we were looking a little scruffy and rough around the edges, I was not about to go to a place that only took cash by the hour. We ended up panhandling, we were doing skits on the train platform, we were doing whatever we could think of. We made there's 21 of us, we made $1,400 in one day panhandling. And we were able to get 3 hotel rooms with cash deposits. So yeah, there was like 7 of us sleeping in each hotel room. And it was better than the alternative. But it's just kind of now like, it's really, really difficult to do things and get services. I mean, even my hairdresser, what's your email address? You don't need my email address to give me a haircut. Oh, we need to look at your cut log. My what? Your cut log. No, we're not creating a cut log, thank you very much. I've had the same haircut since I was 18 years old. I can tell you how to do it without a cut log. But that's it. And why do they want that? Because they want to market to me afterwards. So GDPR has 8 sort of primary, they're not really laws, but they're sort of areas of guidance, principles that they want to enforce. One of them being lawfulness, right? Put some control around people who are collecting information. We want fairness and transparency. We want to know what we're collecting and how it's being used. purpose limitation. I want to say, yes, I'm going to share my information with you, but for these explicit uses, just because you have it doesn't mean you can go run rampant and do whatever you like with it. Data minimization, right? Do you really need to know what year I was born in? Do you need to know what sex I am? Is that important to the transaction that I'm, you know? Do you need to know my sexual orientation? Is that important? In most cases, probably not. Accuracy. I want to know that the information is accurate. So I talked earlier about Equifax and their information they collect from a credit agency perspective. And part of that information, you know, it, or the services they provide, is that you can get a report printed and provided to you on an annual basis. So while I get a copy of mine, usually every couple of years, and I have a look at it. There are inaccuracies in it, right? There are things like incorrect addresses where there's, you know, obviously typos. Someone's done a best effort, but they put the wrong address into the system. There are misspellings of my name, right? So Ian, common spelling mostly for people is I-A-N, so I get that. I also get called Lane a lot because if you have a capital I without serifs on it, people think it looks like an L. I actually answer to Lane in public places where it's not important. Like if I get PA'd in an airport, you know, please report at the counter, I don't even correct people anymore. I just walk out there and say, yeah, that's me. Storage limitation. Okay? How long do you need to keep this data that it's still relevant to the operations that you're providing? And, you know, when you look at that, you think about, a lot of companies will say, well, we have backup tapes, we just keep them forever, just in case. Well, I worked with a company, you may have heard of them, Research in Motion, BlackBerry, and this was a number of years ago. They got into a position where they had a legal situation where they had to provide data for a court proceeding. They had, their policy for their company was we keep data for 2 years. Right, on our information. So this is emails and documents. So we went in there and started looking at that, and they said, oh yeah, where do you keep your backups? It's like, oh, they're in this room. So they take us to the storage room and they open the door up and there's rows of backup tapes. That looks like a lot more than 2 years. Like, oh yeah, no, that's just our policy. We actually keep them forever. So we went back to the court and said, they actually have all these tapes, and the court said, you got it, you produce it. $12 million later, we finished producing all the data. It took 6.5 months, and the courts ended up not taking any action against them for the matter that they were investigating. So big financial lesson learned for a big company that, you know, survived it, but at the same accord, you know, don't put yourself in a position. Keep the things that you need to keep. You know, obviously you've got a regulatory obligation, you've got a requirement for tax purposes, keep it. Beyond that, get rid of stuff because it potentially will only come back and harm you later on. Integrity and confidentiality, right? Protecting that data so that it can't be manipulated or changed, right? We've all seen the, I don't know how many movies there are about people breaking into bank accounts, changing the information, high school students breaking into the school computer, changing their marks, right? That's the integrity component of it. The data is still there, but now it's wrong. Right? Confidentiality, are you protecting it so that it's not being seen by people who shouldn't be? And of course, accountability, and this is the big part. The fines associated to GDPR are massive, potentially. Obviously, no one's got a fine yet, but when we see them come out, there will be some shocks and gasps in the room, I think, from a lot of people. So what has changed? Kind of important stuff here, fines, right? Up to 10 million euros or 2% of global annual turnover. Maximum fine of up to 20 million or 4% of global annual turnover, depending on the level of the fine. So if your company can afford 4% of its gross revenue as a fine, feel free to ignore. But I don't think most companies can, right? Data protection officers. So in some cases, there's now a mandatory obligation to appoint a data protection officer, somebody within the organization who is responsible for that. We'll talk a bit more about when that is required. Privacy seals. This is basically accreditation. So you can actually, well, not yet. Hypothetically, once they come up with a standard, you'll be able to bring a company in who can review your systems and give you a privacy seal for GDPR saying that you are doing all the right things. This is obviously very important from a marketing perspective. If you're a collector of data, you want to be able to go up to your potential clients and say, hey, we have a privacy seal for GDPR. We are doing the right thing to protect your information. Unfortunately, at this point, they haven't actually defined how we're going to get a privacy seal. So at this point, we're basically doing maturity, gap assessments, risk assessments, those kind of things, and providing companies with those reports. Supervisory authorities, right? They've got wide-ranging enforcement powers and investigation powers. The only problem with this is that every country in the EU has a supervising authority. So instead of having one overarching boss, 28 bosses. So we're not quite sure how that's going to play out at the end of the day, because we know that, for example, Belgium has said, oh, we're going to take a supportive compliance method, and Ireland says, we're going to smash people with a hammer. So how those two are going to get along when they cross boundaries remains to be seen. You're going to be expected to have an inventory of your data, know what you have, where you have it, how long do you keep it for, where do you keep it, which form is it in. There's a breach notification requirement. So a lot of people flew under the radar that had data breaches historically by not having to report anything. Now there'll be a 72-hour requirement to report to the regulator and potentially to the data subject if there's a risk. If you lose all your credit card information, you're going to have to report that very, very quickly to the data owner. Security, right? Requirements around monitoring, use of encryption, anonymization of data at rest, so that things, if they do get stolen, can't be necessarily accessed. Conducting a privacy impact assessment, right? So looking at your organization and where does this privacy regulation affect you? What do you need to do to be compliant? How far along the maturity model are you in compliance? And of course, the data subject rights, which we talked a little bit about earlier, right? Some of the new things that are introduced, data portability, the right of your of the data owner to come to you and say, please give me a copy of everything that you hold on my behalf. You have to produce that to them now in an electronic format. I'd like to be erased from your systems because I no longer have a relationship with your company, and okay, if you don't have a legal obligation for tax purposes or something to hold that data, you now have to go through and erase all that information out of your systems. You can't just hang on to it like you could historically. Consent. This is a big key thing, right? We need to get consent from individuals to collect their data, process their data, and then obviously share it or use it for other purposes. We have a requirement as a data processor, right? So if you are one that collects information and you're a data controller, and then you now use a third party to do some sort of manipulation of that data on your behalf, you become responsible for the actions of that data processor. There's obviously a lot more guidance around international transfers. So if you're transferring data between countries outside of the EU back and forward, there are restrictions and controls about how that can happen. So data subject rights, what are we trying to do, right? We're trying to prevent direct marketing. And I said this in my other session, if somebody knows how to stop Flo from texting me three times a day with marketing stuff, let me know, because they're driving me absolutely crazy. I'm an EU citizen, I was born in the UK, I almost want to go back there for a week and say I'm living here. Take me out of your marketing stuff. You can object to automated decisions, right? So for example, banks are using your data now to decide whether or not you're creditworthy for a loan. If that's solely done by a computer, you have the right to say, no, I want a human to look at my file and make a decision, not a computer. Rectify, block, and erase, right? I have the right to ask for erasal of my data. I have the right to ask you to correct incorrect data. I can claim compensation for damages. So what we've seen historically, most companies will come out and say, yeah, we're going to provide you with a year of free credit monitoring on your behalf. But no one's got $1,000 in their pocket for the 4 hours or 10 hours they spent on the phone getting new credit cards and going to get sitting at the DMV, getting a new driver's license because all their information was taken. You have the right to access your own information. You'll notice that Facebook now has the ability to actually download your information. You can look at what Facebook has collected from your site. So how are we going to comply with all this? So here's kind of 12 key things. These are we'll go through these fairly quickly, and then at the end I'm going to stop and I'm going to chunk it down to six things that I want you to worry about when you leave the room. So potentially appointing a privacy officer, you need to consider the need of whether you need a data protection officer. Consider the impact and applicability. Do I even have data belonging to EU citizens who are resident in the EU? If not, guess what? I get a pass. Prepare a record of processing activities. What data do I currently collect? Where do I collect it from? What form do I keep it in? What do I do with it afterwards? What's my lawful basis for processing? Okay, so there are some guidance on the reasons why you can collect and process data. Consider present management of sensitive and children's data. If you collect data of underage people, then you have to have the consent of their parent in most cases to collect that information. Right? A lot of websites, when was your birthday? Are you this old? Guess what? They don't want to collect information of people who are underage. Reviewing and updating privacy notices and management of consent. This whole presentation will be available to everyone, so you don't have to write madly unless you want to. Update, formalize your data breach notification. I can tell you, if you have a data breach and you've got 72 hours to react and prepare to notify people, you do not want to be deciding how you're going to notify people or what form that breach is going to take when you're sitting in a room panicking with your lawyer saying, what do I send out and how am I going to send this? This is something you really want to, you know, if the house is on fire, let's go buy a fire extinguisher, right? It's kind of that mindset.
Yeah.
Look at your third-party data processors, especially if they're overseas, right? A lot of companies here use fund administrators who are based in Canada, in Halifax. A lot of them use services that are based in Ireland, right? Does that affect your company? And if so, what data transference is happening? And have you thought about that? Review policies for privacy by design and privacy impact. This is a concept basically says, when you go to collect information, you need to think about privacy before you collect, right? You need to put these processes in place, and they're not an afterthought anymore. Undertaking a risk assessment, right? Looking at your safeguards. We obviously, larger companies, we are doing cyber maturity assessments. We are looking at providing agreed upon procedures for reviewing security infrastructure. We're doing penetration testing. Last 2 days, we've been doing phishing exercises for a couple of companies, which was really fun because we had one company, we sent out 120 phishing emails. We had 39% of their staff click through, and 27% of their staff put data into the please enter your credentials. It was the worst looking website I've ever seen. Like an 8-year-old coder could have made a better website. One guy put his credentials in 10 times because once you did it and you click submit, the screen went, it just went blank and then sat there, didn't do anything. He put it in 10 times. We got one of their IT people to go for it. Needless to say, management was not particularly happy about that.
Maybe they should give us their names so we don't get
business. They were in another country, which probably we don't deal with. So we're actually going to do a newspaper thing in the next couple of weeks. We're going to put an aggregate of the data that we've got from these phishing things, and we're going to put that in there and basically share it with the public to see this is what's happening, you know, within your company. So keep an eye for that. Appointing a privacy officer and consider whether required to appoint a data protection officer. Okay? I'm not going to read all of these. You can go through and have a look at the sort of the specific detail of this. Basically, if you're not a large entity and you're not basically doing processing of large amounts of data, and of course large is not defined yet, you don't have to appoint a data protection officer. But what we are saying is everyone in this room should have somebody whose privacy is their responsibility, because you don't have someone who's appointed in your company to be that privacy officer, it's just going to fall by the wayside, because you're all here because you had a lot of questions about GDPR. Well, guess what? The people that aren't here have even more questions or don't know anything about it. They are not going to step up and do the tasks that need to be done. Right? Considering impact and applicability. So we talked about this a little bit. Where I think a lot of people are going to fall down is looking at the controllers and processors. Do you share that information with a third party? And if you do, what steps have those third parties taken, right? You should be having conversations with whoever you share data with. It should be part of your contracts that you have with those service providers to ensure that they are complying with relevant regulations. I mean, I would go as far as having them explicitly state that they are following privacy regulations, including GDPR, so that there's just no doubt in anybody's mind.
For instance, now you aware we have clients and you use your bank to pay payments to them. You don't generally go to your bank to say, well, you know, you need to tell me how you protect the information. The bank is there providing that service, but you can't really have an arrangement with them. But you're providing them with data about your client because you have their bank details and stuff like that.
Right.
How you deal with that?
Well, so for so a lot of people in the finance area are sending SWIFTs, right? SWIFTs are a treasure trove of personal information. So the question is, if you're going to share that information with a bank, are they compliant with that?
So we can ask the bank to confirm that they are in compliance?
I mean, they are, I mean, you normally you'll have entered into a contract with, you'll have a signed contract with them, right? Before you're allowed to be part of the SWIFT network. I'm not going to throw any stones, but I am pretty sure that I bet you all the banks on this island are probably not fully compliant with GDPR yet.
They're basically going to have the most sensitive information on people.
They do. Yeah, absolutely. Right? That and healthcare information.
We
all read the newspaper. Right. We've had some healthcare issues recently in relation to stuff. This is going to be an evolving process. Right? You're not going to sever your relationship with the bank because they won't say that they're GDPR compliant today, right? But it is things that you need to worry about going forward and be considerate as you do business with these entities. There are questions that you need to raise with them when you're having meetings with them, when you're having board meetings with them, that kind of stuff, right? There is no silver bullet answer to that. Preparing a record of processing activities. We haven't really talked about this. And this is basically going through and sort of doing somewhat of a data inventory. What do I have? What do I collect? But more so, what am I doing with this data once I have it, right? What kind of activities am I performing? Am I doing analysis for the purpose of anti-money laundering compliance? I'm looking at, I need this information. I need the country of residence for this information, for this individual, because I need to know if they're on a high-risk jurisdiction list because of that, right? So these are the kind of things you have to think through. And look at field by field when you're collecting information, is this something I really need? And if so, what's the purpose of that, right? Because if it's just for the purpose of marketing, then all of a sudden you need to get consent from that individual to be able to market and hold that information. If it's for the purpose of a regulatory obligation, usually a contract or a subscription that you have with that individual will then allow you and give you authority to collect, and then usually the laws of related to banking and tax information will require that you keep that for 7 years, regardless of whether the client says, get rid of this, right? You have an obligation under law to then keep that. Establishing that lawful basis for process. So this is what I talked about here, right? Consent versus a legal obligation, right? So from a consent perspective, people are saying, I am giving you that information. Signing a subscription agreement that says we're going to collect your data for the purposes of tax, banking, et cetera, is a form of consent, right? You now have a legal obligation to keep that information, usually for a period of 7 years. So, there are different forms of consent. How many people here do web-based or direct marketing activities? One, two, okay. So I find most people we've talked to are not into that space. It's basically, their clients, people come to them. You can market to those individuals, but you need to basically get express consent from them, especially if you're sending them emails and that kind of stuff. They have to know that their data is being used for that, and they have to have the ability to opt out of that if they don't want it. So, I'm hoping that January 1st will be a lineup of people at Flow saying, stop doing this. No. Take this message back if you are. It really drive me crazy.
Actually, for the Kim and Lourdes, they're coming, is it going to be mirrored in such a way with those fines?
I don't think the fines are going to be as high. No, we don't want to, cripple the industry on the country. But the fine piece of it, I think, is still yet to be defined.
What
just like the AML stuff has just come out, even though we've had AML laws for a long time.
It's going to mirror it generally, but the fact that maybe a little more reasonable.
We don't know. Yeah.
So there's no draft out, I guess?
In relation to fines for GDPR?
No, I'm saying into the version for Cayman. Is there any draft?
It would be a separate document.
No, I'm saying it's a draft of it.
I haven't seen it yet.
Okay.
Review and update privacy notices and management of consent, right? So privacy notices, I'm sure everyone has noticed that every website you go to lately has, we use cookies, please click here to accept, okay? Does everybody know what a cookie is?
Yeah.
So a cookie is basically something that tracks behind the scenes based on your IP address or a unique identifier, and then when you come back to that website, it knows how many times you've been there, what you looked at last time, and it tracks all that information for you. Obviously, that collects personally identifiable information, and therefore they want you to click, yes, I accept it, I'm going to use cookies. Putting out these privacy notices is obviously important because people, that's the thing that people see, right? So this is the thing that we are all seeing. We had a big, huge batch of emails that were coming up. If you want to stay on our list, you know, please click here or resubscribe, re-enter your information. That was all part of GDPR compliance that pushed that in early May. Talked a bit about breach notification procedures, right? So, you know, the way it works is basically if you've got data of an individual, depending on the country where that person resides, they're going to have an authority that's responsible for that country. So if you've got a data breach, the expectation is you're going to notify the authorities of each of the countries that are affected by that data breach. So this is not an easy task, and now you're going to be dealing with numerous regulators. Right? So we all know what it's like dealing with one regulator. Now you could be potentially dealing with 28 regulators. So as I'm saying, you know, put some thought to that, how you're going to deal with that. At least whose role is it? Whose responsibility to manage that? Are you going to outsource it? You're going to have external legal counsel in-house, you know, not the CEO, maybe not the marketing person who's going to be inundated with emails and phone calls about what happened to my information, my data, my money. You need to be able to notify what the nature of the breach is, right? Within 72 hours of becoming aware, you got to identify who the data protection officer is, figure out what the consequences of the breach are. This is an iterative process. Oftentimes when cyber professionals come in, it's going to be one of these, okay, we know you have a breach. Now we're going to collect data, we're going to image computers, we're going to start looking through logs. Sometimes that information isn't necessarily available in 72 hours. So it's an iterative process. You tell them what you know, and then as you learn things, you then disclose that information as you go forward. Right? What are you doing to remedy it? Are you taking your systems down? Are you notifying people? You know, depending on what's lost, what is the risk associated with that information loss? Is it just names and email addresses? Fairly low. Is it personal information, including, you know, dates of birth, credit card information, basically a whole packet of identity theft information? And then for the individual, you know, do we need to notify the individual? So most of the time it basically says, notification without undue delay in a case where a high risk to the rights and freedoms of the individual, right? So that is the cases where they're at a risk for potential privacy or for identity theft, right? So if enough information has been leaked where someone's identity could be stolen, you have an urgent obligation to notify. If the data is encrypted and is not in a readable form, so if I lose my laptop today on the way home, the good news is this laptop is encrypted and basically the data on here, including client stuff and personal information, is protected. Even if somebody gets the device, they're basically not going to be able to do anything with it. We would not have an obligation to notify the clients that I've lost my laptop.
Would you still have an obligation to notify the
You should laptop? Still be notifying the commissioner, yeah. Right, and just basically saying, here's the circumstance, this is the breach that occurred, however, the risk to the individual is basically zero because the data is encrypted and therefore, you know, we've protected that asset. But it is technically still a breach, right? Because with enough monkeys and enough typewriters, you potentially could decrypt that information if you had a supercomputer, but the risk of that happening are pretty slim if it's been stolen out of your car in a parking lot. Things think about international transfers. This is, I think, is going to trip people up, right? So different countries outside the EU also have regulations on how they transfer stuff. There are some things like adequate countries, right? So Switzerland, Canada, Argentina, Israel, Uruguay have been deemed as equivalent jurisdictions. So you can transfer information between Canada and the EU back and forth without taking any other steps as long as you're following the laws of Canada. The US Privacy Shield, which is coming into force, the intention of that is to try and do that. They really don't, they're not in a position yet where they can just transfer information back and forward. And of course, if you've got consent, right? If your client says, yeah, no problem, you can send my data, I'm okay with that. Then you're gonna, then obviously you're in a position where you can do that. Talked a little bit earlier about contracts, making sure that privacy, you know, things such as responsibilities for GDPR, responsibilities for, you know, how data is going to be transferred. Is it gonna be encrypted? What systems are gonna be, you know, transferred through? What form? Is it going to be readable? Is it going to be in a structured database? Is it going to be unstructured data? All these things should really be thought through to make sure that you understand. I mean, you have to think of the internet. For somebody who has cyber capabilities, the internet is like putting a bunch of information on a billboard on a truck and driving it down the highway. There are people out there that can simply read the information as it goes by, so you need to protect that. The average person in this room probably doesn't have the ability to do that, but certainly that's how data travels on the internet. It just freeform and out there. It's basically cruising around with its pants down. Rights of individuals. We talked a little about this earlier. Some of the things that are going to cause a little bit of problems, I think, are going to be data portability. So this is when a client comes to you and says, please produce all of my information that you have. You have to produce it back to them in an electronic format. It's not defined in how it has to be structured, but obviously it has to be in a form that that person can access and read once you turn it over to them. So it can't be in a proprietary structure. This is going to be difficult because this could relate to things that are in backup tapes. It could be stuff that's on your life system, archive, at your data processor, not with you. It's a holistic collection of that. You know, this is where it comes into collect only the things you need. Because if you've got a lot of stuff and spread out all over the place, and you can bet that if you are subject to a data breach, that's probably when you're going to receive a whole bunch of these requests, because people are going to say, well, what did you have of mine? I want to know. Mentioned privacy by design a little bit earlier. This is basically the concept of thinking about privacy before. So if you're going to be putting out new products and services, especially from a financial industry perspective, you're probably going to be collecting information that you need to be able to provide that service, right? Whether you're offering somebody an investment opportunity, whether you're offering a banking service, whether you're offering credit for purchase of products, whatever it is, that information, you need to think about that up front. Historically, security has always been an afterthought exercise. We'll get the thing up and running, we'll start selling, making money, and then we'll come back and figure out if we're protecting this afterwards. This has to be part of the forethought, right, that goes into presenting a new product or service. So, you know, when you have those meetings with your marketing folks about, oh yeah, we're thinking about this new tool, the product we're gonna put out. Your cyber people, your IT people, should be also sitting at the table saying, okay, well, what are you collecting? Have you thought about this? How are we gonna disseminate that information? Right, and these are the principles, obviously, we wanna be thinking about while we do that, right? Personal data is only collected, you know, we don't collect beyond the minimum necessary for the purpose of processing. We make sure that they're retained for only the minimum amount of time that we need to. We don't process things for the purpose of things that we didn't originally collect data for, that we don't have consent for. I think there's going to be companies that are going to find themselves offside on that. Information is not disseminated or shared to the public, right? So we're going to share out our results of our phishing exercises, right? So we're going to put that out to the public domain. However, it's going to be anonymized and it's going to be aggregated so that even with the information that you're going to be provided, there's no way that you could attribute it back to a company or an individual even associated with that company, right? Can't sell a person. personal data unless you have consent, right? This used to be the big thing, was collect information, aggregate it, and then sell it to another marketing company so that they could use it. That happened a lot. I can guarantee you in the banking industry, a lot of that information was sold for the purpose of, you know, your bank will be phoning you up from a different department or a totally unrelated legal entity saying, hi, you qualified for a mortgage, you qualified for this, you know, service or credit card. Oh, hi, we'd like to offer you insurance. Really? The bank sells insurance? I didn't know that. Now you do. Why? Because we're going to market it to you. Look at a privacy impact assessment, okay? So this is basically looking at the processes that you have in place, the maturity model of basically being compliant with GDPR and other privacy regulations, seeing where you are, okay? And looking at how it's going to affect your business. What we are seeing, so our program that we put in place is basically, we got 39 things that we test against, and there are 5 scales from 1 to 5 of where you can be compliant. We're working with some large global companies. We're talking $20-30 million engagements. We've got 100 staff in their offices doing this work globally. Their rating is maybe a 1 or a 2. Huge companies, totally unprepared for all of this. It's just the nature of where we are in dealing with this. Small business is very unprepared for this, and this is going to be quite a burden on a lot of companies. Look at your security safeguards. Obviously, if you're not doing penetration testing on your web servers, if you're not looking at where you're storing your information, or even going out to your third-party provider. So if you're using a third-party cloud, right? Everyone's heard of the cloud, right? Which basically means it's a computer that you don't own that's sitting in somebody else's building. You're renting computer space. What are those guys doing to ensure that those systems are protected and that your data is not going to be exposed? Right? Is your data on the same server as another company's data? Is there a potential for cross-contamination or potential for somebody to cross over from their operating system into your operating system, be exposed to that information? Is your data being stored on the same storage system, right, as another company? Might be okay, might not be okay. Do you know the answer to that? Probably not. Look at things like data at rest. You need to keep things for a long period of time, but you don't need to access them. Consider encrypting that data, right? Put it into an archive state. I have it if I need it, but if I lose it or it's exposed, it doesn't put me at risk. Figure out, if you look at your client lists, right? You look at where you're getting data from. A lot of you will probably have a couple of countries who are sort of your primary place of residence for people, right? You may have a lot of UK citizens, you may have a lot of, you know, whatever it is, Germany. Basically figure out who that lead supervisory authority is, the one that you're going to phone first if you have an incident. I'm guessing what's going to happen is within the EU is that countries are going to say, that lead authority is going to be responsible for managing that investigation and that enforcement on the relation to a breach. But not all, you know, no, 28 countries don't want to have to go after you all at once. They have to figure out who it is. So you want that first point of call, obviously, to figure out who that lead is going to be. Okay. So, a lot of information, a lot of things to think about. What do I need to do right now? You heard the speech. You can go if you want. These are the 6 things that I want you to consider when you walk out of the room today. Obviously, the implementation date has passed, right? If you don't have these things done, you are technically in breach of GDPR. So, appoint an individual to assume the data privacy responsibilities. You need somebody who's going to champion this exercise for you. You don't necessarily have to appoint that data protection officer role, which is basically notifying the regulator, that supervisory authority, who your data protection officer is. There's going to be very few people that are going to have to do it here. The banks, probably. Maybe some of the larger fund administrators, potentially. They've got a lot of information. But some of the smaller entities, there isn't a definition of what large data processing is. And so we're gonna see that stuff eventually come out in case law, or we're gonna see guidance notes that come out that give some sort of definition to what that's gonna look like. Review and revise your external privacy notices to ensure they are GDPR compliant, okay? Including but not limited to your lawful basis for collection and processing, okay? So what this is the glass house. So your clients are looking in, you know, at your business. What they see first is all these notifications that have been coming out, right? The only reason I know that some of the, my people who have my data are actively doing this is because I've got an email from them saying, please, you know, continue your consent to this email. We're using cookies, please click here to accept that. Those are the client-facing things that people are seeing. If you're doing those, people will have a perception, regardless of whether or not there's a lot of weeds growing in the backyard, that you've got your act in order, okay? If you fail to do that, it is very, very obvious to people that you haven't gone down this path. What does that notice need to include? Right, your controller's identity. Who's the point of contact within your organization so someone have a question, right? What is the purpose of processing, right? We're collecting this information to provide you with financial services relating to ABC, whatever. You know, details of disclosures. So that's basically, if in the event of a data breach, you're notified, in the event that your data is subject to placing you at a level of risk, we will reach out to you by your contact information, whatever it is. How to exercise your data subject rights. If you would like access to your information, if you would like to correct an incorrect record, or if you would like to request your information to be deleted, this is the process and the person that you're going to reach out to. Obtain consent from your EU resident clients for the collection and processing of the personal data. So this is the one relating to mostly marketing stuff. So if you have a subscription agreement or some sort of contract to provide a financial service, which I'm presuming that most people in the room are in that boat, you're likely not going to have to go out and do a new level of consent. What I would say is your new subscription agreements that you're putting out now should have a clause in there that is very clear about GDPR, why you're collecting and what you're processing, right? So you want to put that information in there so that you've got the consent. You can rely on the sort of the historical consent of those existing contracts, as long as you don't give people the information that they need to be able to contact you. But if you're doing direct marketing, super, super important. This is where people are going to file complaints. So May 25th, GDPR enforcement went live. Google and Facebook, instantly people filed complaints against both of them with the regulators. They were like chomping at the bit. As soon as the clock ran over, they fired off their complaints. So consent. One of the key things about consent, we're getting close to the end. You can see everybody rubbing their bellies. One of the key things about consent is the fact that it needs to be unambiguous. So historically, we've paid a lot of very smart lawyers a lot of money to write things that people don't understand. The requirement now is it must be in plain English so that the average layperson can read it and understand what it means. It'd be interesting to see if some of the lawyers can actually put themselves in the shoes to be able to write those documents. You may be better off getting your kids to do a first draft and then have somebody proofread it afterwards. Consent should not be separate from, or should be separate from other terms and conditions. You're not allowed to bury consent inside other big long documents. It needs to be very clear. You're not allowed to use pre-tick opt-in boxes, so that's why we're having to click on all these cookies, is because we're not allowed to pre-tick boxes. We're not allowed to have you accept our privacy and acceptable use policy. We now have to manually click on all those things. It's just showing that you had at least some level of intent, whether or not you read it, you still had some level of intent by clicking on it. It requires granular consent for distinct processing operations. So if I'm using your stuff for marketing and I'm also using it to provide you financial service, I need consent for both of those types of things. Whether it's implied consent through a subscription agreement or whether you've got this direct, I agree and can opt out. You must keep clear records. So as a company that of course has a whole lot of auditors in it, we like to come in and be able to look at those documents and confirm that yes, you have done ABC like you said you have. If you don't have those things on file, regulators and auditors are not going to be happy, and of course you're going to be finding yourself a foul, despite whether you've done the right thing or not. And you're going to want to obviously show, include in that consent, the right for people to withdraw, right? So right for people to withdraw. And we talked about earlier about consent, whether it was for a legal purpose or whether it was from, you know, from an individual consent perspective. If somebody says, I want to withdraw, but you have a legal obligation to maintain those records, you can deny their request to withdraw their information from your organization. Conduct a data audit to identify what personal data you hold. You don't know what you have, where you have it, or what you do with it. You're going to find it very, very difficult to implement any type of controls around this, right? This could be a Excel spreadsheet of what we have, high level, you know, here's all the documents and information we have, and then working down to a granular level as you go into what fields do we collect on each form, and why do we collect that information, what do we do with it? But you gotta start somewhere, right? Knowing what you have and where it is really the key point to begin with. And also, don't just think about this being electronic. It also applies to paper records as well. And then updating your policies and procedures. So you've kind of done that client facing outward, clean the windows on the house, everything looks good. Now we're gonna come inside and tidy up, vacuum and dust, right? We need to update those policies and procedures and ensuring that that stuff inside our company is compliant and outlines these rights. Because I can tell you right now that even though you now know that somebody has the right to request data erasure, you have no idea how you're actually gonna implement that today. You may tell a client you have the right to request that, and still not have an idea how you're gonna implement that, right? This is that stage. Okay, we're here, how do we figure out how we're gonna do this? Bring in the IT people, we all sit down at the table and we start answering these tough questions. How do people, you know, how are we gonna produce data if somebody asks for a copy of it? How are we gonna delete the stuff? How do we correct it? Who's the person we're gonna talk to? All this stuff needs to be documented so obviously you can move forward Consider conducting a privacy maturity assessment. You know, this is obviously something that you're impacted by scale. You know, we certainly have the capabilities to come in and tell you where you are in relation to compliance. I would say this is probably more suited for medium to large size businesses. Unfortunately, just the amount of labor, as you can imagine, that's involved in reviewing all this stuff and writing reports is probably not suited to small business. But you know, if you find yourself in a position, if you've got global operations, this is something you probably really should be looking at doing is, you know, get a benchmark. Where do you stand? Because then at least you know, you can decide what you're aiming for as far as your target going forward. And we can do all those things like, you know, conducting the data audit and all those types of stuff. You know, we can obviously assist with those. So is everyone sufficiently scared now? Okay. So I mentioned earlier, right? We talked about AML. Regulations or the laws are this thick, the guidance notes are this thick, and it's taken years for those guidance notes to be developed. We're gonna see the exact same thing happen with GDPR, right? There's going to be questions that people ask that we don't have the answer to. We don't know how these data privacy seals are gonna work, for example. Nobody knows. We don't know if a breach happens, how this, you know, singular supervisory authority is gonna take over, or are they gonna share responsibilities between regions? We don't know. What we do know is that Reuters went out and did a survey of all 28 countries, went to the regulators, the supervisory authorities, and said, are you prepared for GDPR to act in your role? Do you have the staff that you need? Do you have the funding that you need? And they came back and said, absolutely not. So 17 of 24 that responded, authorities responded and said they did not yet have necessary funding, lacked initial powers to fulfill their GDPR duties. So they are as ill-prepared as, you know, maybe some of the people in the room are. And I think that is a good thing. My message to people is don't be the low-hanging fruit on the tree. Right now, obviously, these guys are going to be overwhelmed with the Facebook and the Google complaints and the big companies, right? That stuff is going to consume them. Where you're probably at risk is in the event you have a data breach, someone is potentially going to file a complaint against your company. That's when you're going to come to the attention of the regulator. It's not going to be like here where you're going to get a letter from the supervising authority of the UK saying, please send us a copy of your policies and procedures, we'd like to review them. They just do not have the capability to do that, because this applies to every company, right, on the planet. They do not have the horsepower to be able to deal with this. So it's going to be one of those, if you deal with the outward facing things that your clients see, you know, you start to work on getting stuff sort of behind the scenes, you're probably going to be in a pretty good stead, because I can guarantee you there are millions of companies that aren't probably doing anything and are going to be the ones that are going to find themselves, you know, in hot water. This type of stuff, breaches related to privacy, are really, really tough on companies' reputations. Depending on the size of your organization and the service you provide, it really puts you at a potential risk for a significant loss of your client base. I can tell you, for example, in Canada, we have a lot of what are called money services businesses. These are like your Western Unions, the people that do foreign exchange. We have a lot of them, a lot. You go to Montreal, you can literally not walk more than 20 feet without being able to change your money to another denomination. These companies are quite small. They have AML obligations just like everybody else. A bunch of them got fined for non-compliance. We went out and actually sent somebody from our office, depending on what city it was in, sent somebody out to have a look. Every single one of those MSPs that had been fined didn't exist a year later. They all went out of business, you know, because of the impact. The fines were only, you know, $5,000-$6,000, but nobody wanted to bank with them, nobody wanted to deal with them, nobody wanted to give them private information, and they disintegrated. And that's really where I think the risk is for organizations here. It's, you know, society is getting, I'm pissed off that companies can't protect my information. I don't want to give my private information out anymore. I don't need a cut log, right? Why do I want to give my information to somebody that doesn't need it and clearly is, you know, likely doesn't have the infrastructure or capability to protect that stuff? You know, there's a interesting engagement we're working on currently. We're basically, you know, looking at, give away the details, but we're basically looking at government infrastructure, right? That stores a lot of this information. And our, you know, goal is to try and find if we can poke holes in the systems that they put in place to determine whether or not, you know, where any of that data is at risk. I applaud the government for taking proactive measures to do that. I mean, the joke in the office is this is the Mission Impossible. So we actually were in server rooms the other day, looking underneath the floors, we were popping ceiling tiles, looking over walls, checking the integrity of the physical, you know, infrastructure of the buildings, and you know, that's all part of this, right? Can you crawl from the public bathroom through the ceiling into the IT server room? That's an important thing to know. Thankfully, no, you can't.
Actually, for the beneficial ownership register, where they have this offline thing,
yeah,
have you had a chance to look at that and see if it's actually foolproof as they make it to be?
If I knew anything about that, I wouldn't be able to speak a word about it anyways. That would breach client confidentiality.
No, I'm in terms, oh well, okay, you are on the side of, okay, sorry.
Okay, so, a lot of information there. Questions?
Document storage.
Yes.
We talked about data, but obviously there's a whole bunch of information in document storage. How is that going to translate to somebody who's got warehouses and they're storing that, all that information? How's that?
Sure. So you're talking about, well, it could be, document storage could be, I'd say, one of two things. You're going to have paper files, banker's boxes that are going to be in cold storage, or you could potentially have things like electronic data on backup tapes that may also be in banker's boxes in cold storage. If that data in there contains stuff that's relevant to GDPR regulation, there has to be controls put around that, right? So in that case, you're looking at physical controls. Most of those places, I mean, I don't know who provides those services here. In North America, Iron Mountain is the big name. They obviously have vaults and storage facilities where they store their stuff, big warehouses, alarm systems, controls, security guards, all that kind of stuff put around that. Inventory, record control, sign-in logs, sign-out logs. Those are the kind of things that would be expected to be put in place for, you know, paper type storage. You're not accessing the data, you're not really using it, but you have a duty to protect it from theft.
You made quite a few mentions of the EU.
Yes.
Very soon, Britain won't be part of the EU, and by extension, neither will we. Is our law here intended to be a standalone, or how will it affect?
Two things. So, England has come out, Great Britain has come out, and basically said that it is their intention, if they, if and when, I'm still not 100% sure, we'll see what happens. If the separation occurs, their intention is that they will either sign some sort of agreement that will basically mirror what the what GDPR does, or they will enact their own law, which is going to basically be the exact, same stuff. We're not expecting any changes at this point between that. And then we talk about here, right? Even if we somehow, become separated by virtue of extension, the goal of the government here is to become an equivalent jurisdiction, which means that they want to have the same level of controls that GDPR has, so that we can then fire data back and forth between European countries without having any extra.
So to keep off the EU blacklist.
I'm not going to preach politics, but yes, I'm sure there's things that we do to keep ourselves in the good books of our onshore friends. Yes?
Did you have any sense of whether the Cayman Data Protection Law will achieve equivalent jurisdiction status? I mean, it's out there. Are we kind of wishing and hoping, or is it?
Speaking from my personal thoughts on this topic, not representing the company, I have some exposure to that. I'm also the chair of the data protection group for finance. We have a lot of discussions about where we want to be. Obviously, there's some companies here that are very, very adamant that they do not want to have equivalent requirements because they feel that they're burdensome. I can tell you that Jude's perspective is that we do, want to avoid putting ourselves in a position where we hamper the ability for us to be competitive in a market, right? So, for example, if we're collecting, privacy is a big thing for what we're known about. And if we all of a sudden have to collect information and especially put it into a public registry, that is going to, there's a risk that that's going to harm our business compared to other offshore jurisdictions that don't have to do that. One of the things I think the general sort of thought in the proposed laws for here is there hasn't been enough thought and detail put into the writing in relation to finance stuff. So we have a lot of, I can tell you, coming here, I spent 4 months in Bermuda last year, learned all sorts about insurance operations and things that happened there. And then it's like I just finally got captives a little bit clearer in my head. I come here, and of course you've got all sorts of other services and structures, and a lot of stuff here is funds and investment things, and it's quite unique. And the detail that's in the actual legislation doesn't delve into the uniqueness, right? So one of the examples we had the other day was, so somebody registers their mega yacht here, and they've got a staff group of staff that are from other countries around the world that work on this boat. They don't actually reside here, and they have no protections under our employment law, but because they are the company's register here, do we know how now have Cayman obligations to protect their data underneath that law? Even though they'll never set foot on land here, and the only connection is that they are a Cayman, the boat is registered here. And the answer was, we don't know. But guess what? There's no clarity within the regulation as it stands to how you're going to deal with that circumstance. What if you've got a family office, for example? Right? So if you're a family office and the only data that you're dealing with is all of your family folks, do you have to get consent from other people within the family office arrangement? Right? Do I have to get consent from my brother to use his data as part of our investment schemes? Or and that stuff just doesn't seem like it's been fleshed out. We've asked for more time with the committee to try and draw some of that out. At this point, we haven't got a response. It's interesting. They want to be an equivalent jurisdiction. They feel that that's good for them on the public stage.
But January 1st, 2019, that law is in effect,
yep.
Right? So this, at that date, we won't be in equivalent jurisdiction. We still have to address a lot of other things in order to come to equivalent jurisdiction?
Yeah, I don't know what the exact awardance of that is, so it's up to the EU to decide whether they're going to grant us that or not. I'm sure there's people behind the scenes in government that are having those conversations, but I'm unfortunately not privy to this.
You expect there'll be a protracted timeline, right? So January 1st, EU doesn't care about us still.
No, absolutely not. Because the other thing is who's going to be the supervisory authority that's going to make that decision, right? Is it going to fall to one? Do all 28 have to vote us through? Because my understanding is a lot of the working committees that went into developing GDPR are being disbanded now that it's been brought into force. So, you know, where's the bodies that are going to make these decisions that were made historically if those working committees don't exist anymore?
For an equivalent jurisdiction, does that jurisdiction have a authority that you report to? And if you report to that authority, do you still have to report to all 28 other authorities?
Like, for instance, where the prospect protocol.